Okay. Let's not do something we're gonna regret. Okay. Why is the box out here? I should have thrown that shit out. But it does make you question, though. What's in the cat box?
Actually kinda impressed, and I'm not saying that to be facetious, but actually I'm kinda impressed that out of all the episodes we've had with Catbox Comics, shameless shilling here for you to check out the other videos, they all seem to center around the same sort of issues. Chicks with more cleavage than personality trips into a relationship with the overglorified self-insert of the author and artist who more times than not seem to have bishy long anime hair. And then you kinda just, you know, cover it all up with gigantic butts and even bigger tits, flashy colors, and a half-assed attempt on making both humor and drama. It doesn't matter whether it's a farm, or beach, or even an anime convention, these things seem to be the backbone of all Catbox comics that we've covered thus far, making me question whether the creators were truly aware of the comic's content when they came up with the name Catbox. And that is actually one of the reasons why this segment is called What's in the Catbox. Cause I truly do wanna know. Philip Brown is a cool guy, and Nakone seems to be a super cool dude as well. I already show my adoration for Skid and Foofy, and despite what most people think, I'd love nothing more than to sit down and enjoy a cold beer with the creators of Les Lindas. I truly do believe that there will be stuff in the cat box that will make me give a positive review, and if I have to shove my hand into this litter box and scurry through shit to find it, then so be it. Hey, it's not my fault this analogy works so well. You made the name. Today's comic is Rascals, a comic made by the artist and author Kelvin Challenger, better known as Master Godai. The comic is listed as an action-adventure comedy and drama comic, started in September 2009, and is rated E for everyone on the Wiki Fur. And yes, again, friendly reminder such a thing exists. I wonder what you'll find if you click the random page button. Muscle fuck. Muscle fuck is a mature first speak term where a character's muscle is thrust into a vaginal or anal cloaca opening. It can also be used to refer to the act of penile thrusting into a muscle during oral sex. So let's just get
right
into the comic. And you know what? This first page isn't exactly that bad. It's cute, there's life in the picture, and you get an easy understanding of these two's relationship. And then there's the logo. Now, I'm of the firm belief that anything that's not this is immediately an improvement, and frankly, I thought this logo was super neat when I first saw it. With the name Rascals and this logo, I was immediately under the impression that we'd have to do with some, well, rascals who do small crimes, and the logo here made me think of graffiti that fit a small crime for a rascal really well. The problem is that, well, even I, pasty white boy from Denmark, have tagged more buildings than these guys. And that's because I've done that once. Like, it's stylish, but comparing it to what's going on in the story, it's a little too stylish. but I'm getting ahead of myself. We start the comic off with someone driving to Faunamis City, and I actually really liked this page at first. Most of all because I missed the My Name is Chris McCloud thing here. Cause then I just saw someone in a car with some boxes on the back that said Chrissy's stuff. Do we really need to know what her name is? Like, said out loud? Can't we safely assume her name is Chrissy from the boxes on the back? And even the M on one of the boxes can tell us her name is Chrissy M. I don't know, it's just a small thing. Anyway, Chrissy here has come to the city to start college as a graphic designer.
Not quite there yet.
We get our first shot of Chrissy as she finds her new place. She is, however, shocked to find that her room, room 326, is up a flight of stairs. The hell did you expect, lady? 300 plus rooms in just one massive straight line? Anyway, Chrissy enters her new room to find that it's absolutely massive, and from the looks of it, it is bigger than most actual apartments. So to make sure the reader doesn't get bored of the lack of funny punchlines, instead of, you know, looking around the place for any dorm roommates, she instead goes straight to the shower where this guy yanks aside the shower curtain to record her with his video camera.
Isn't this just a surefire way to get yourself kicked out of college?
Anyway, of course, cause anime, Chrissy starts beating the shit out of the camera guy who screams out he thought it was someone else in the shower. Really? You were gonna record someone naked and vulnerable in the shower? For what reason? Plus, as the lady here in a t-shirt that literally tells people to stare at her tits says, this is a unisex dorm. At no point did you think there was a chance you could, in a freaking dorm, accidentally drop in on someone else. But hey, yeah, cool prank.
My nigga, you just got pranked!
Anyway, it turns out that the red-haired guy here is Quick. Is that a real name? And the one he wanted to pull the prank on was this guy here, Sky. After Chrissy goes to get dressed, the two talk about how much Quick wanna fuck Chrissy. Now, I wanted to make another drinking game with this comic, but I realized that if I did that with what I had in mind, it would make Les Lindas look like a goddamn AA meeting. And actually, what I wanted was simply reinstate the drinking game that every time something was over the top sexy for no reason at all, you would take a shot. The problem, however, is that this comic gets to page 136 without even once failing to make at least something in the page focus around sex. Be it showcasing of the characters' bodies, straight up provocative stuff, showing the characters in underwear, or even just talking about how much they want to fuck someone. This comic does this on every single page for 136 pages straight. I want to shit on it, but that's actually kind of impressive. Anyway, Chrissy is getting dressed and is immediately talking to herself out loud how cute the two guys are, even including the guy who just videotaped her naked in the shower.
Wait, hold on. This careless abandon of a mistake done by a male character, could it be? Oh, yeah.
As Chrissy is getting dressed, a ninja bunny rabbit poof out of nowhere into existence, offering Chrissy some takeout as welcome, says her name is Reiko, and asks if she wants to make out to celebrate that she's no longer the only girl around. Okay, so what the fuck? Why is that ninja? Is it a joke? Her name is Reiko? Really? And you're gonna make sexual advances on a new kid on first meeting her? I get that it's a joke, but when you first introduce your character, the information you give is kinda sorta gonna stick as a basis for understanding the character. And last but not least, I thought you weren't the only girl. Because of the girl in the stair t-shirt? If this wasn't in your dorm room, maybe show that. And even more so, if it wasn't in the dorm room, did everyone just meet her in the hallway while she was just wearing a towel? And if so, how did you know she was your roommate? This is actually a thing I've been talking with Philip Brown about a lot, and it's the problem where your character takes up too much of the frame. Thus far, Godai is doing the exact same mistake as Philip, which is doing the four-piece meal, showing the character only from the front, to the back, or the two sides. As of such, they just stand there in the frame and take up the vast majority of the entire thing, making it hard for you to establish where they are in accordance to other things. And I know that it can be hard to put a character into a 3D space, but at least you won't be confusing people in your story. Use establishing shots, show where characters are in accordance to where they were before. A color change of the background isn't enough for us to know a location has changed. They might just as well be standing in front of a different wall in the same room.
I'll admit it was a nitpicky transition, but I just really wanted to talk about it because it is an issue further into the comic as well.
The next strip shows that bygones are bygones, as Chrissy wishes to play Fur of War with Quick. Get it, guys? She's a super hot gamer girlfriend? The kind most teenage nerds wish they had? Get it? Anyway, Reiko comes in and gropes Chrissy while telling her she's gotten her a job and wants to see her tits in the work uniform. Classy. The next page is this Aso guy who is mad at Sky because apparently Aso is hooking up with Sky's ex. And because he's been going to town on her, when Aso was eating her out, it was like, and I quote, E.T. taking a nap between her legs. So Reiko takes Chrissy to work and... Nope. Can't be asked to do a city drawing. Alright. I suppose this now means this is in the real world. Great! Sure! So, Chrissy immediately gets hired due to being sexy and then has to pick between the sexy outfit of a pirate or a ninja. Oh sweet Jesus, are you serious? The ninja versus pirates meme is from 2006, dude! Anyway, Chrissy isn't really selling much, but Reiko has a genius idea of coating them both in vanilla ice cream.
It's cum, guys! Get it? It's cum! Come! We are only about 15 pages in, and this comic has already made my claim that Yosh is objectifying women so redundant that Inagaki is telling it to calm down. Okay, roll the clip.
Motherfucking Inagaki!
Motherfucking Inagaki!
Oh yes!
I love that clip so much.
Anyway, Chrissy has her first day at college and finds out she has gotten an assignment that makes up 50% of her grades, and so Quick decides to help Chrissy study, if only for staring at her tits, and because Chrissy says she'll repay Quick with, and I quote, anything you want. And instead of, you know, wishing for a date, or a kiss, or just spend more time with her in general, he jumps immediately to, I want to joyride on your Swiss Alps. I won't lie, that's pretty good. Luckily, however, Chrissy has passed out from the studying and is now out cold. Anyway, the only real reason for this whole thing is so that Chrissy can get a perfect score and thus the teacher wishes to date Chrissy. Really professional there, champ. Good job. When Chrissy gets home, she's welcomed by Reiko, who rewards her by licking her cheek. Huh. Can we just... you know, check that box. Thank you! So, super many quotes-unquotes drama ensues because now Quick has a competitor and Reiko just dropped the bomb on Chrissy that Quick got the hots for her, even though he hit it about as well as a 14-year-old hides his porn mags. Quick is distressed by this because now how is he gonna ask her to the concert of which he has gotten two tickets, which are, again, kudos for the term, get laid tickets. Again, won't lie, that's a great fucking term. XD, my friend, lols, Ruffalmow, and all that stuff. Anyway, Sky decides to help Quick by calling in a friend of his who he can then share the tickets with. Is it just me, or could you not just talk with Chrissy? Go, hey girl, I got these tickets for you. You wanna go see Dante Maximum, or do you wanna enjoy coffee with your professor? And Chrissy can then pick accordingly? Or she could, I don't know, grab a cup of coffee during the afternoon and then go to the concert during the evening. Is this just gonna be another one of those stories where no one seems to talk? Anyway, Chrissy bumps into Quick and Raven, who are out driving on Quick's moped. Obviously, this gets Chrissy pissy and she decides to prolong the date with the teacher. Yes, this is indeed the most run-of-the-mill drama thing you've ever seen. You watch any chick romance flick with little to no time put into it, and you will have the exact same plot. It's ridiculous. Don't ask why I know that. While Chrissy is taking a spectator seat to Reiko and Sky's sex life, we move back to Quick and Raven, the girl Sky got to go with Quick to the concert with. I gotta admit, I actually liked how Raven seemed to know that the tickets weren't for her, but isn't making a huge thing out of it. She still had a good time and ends up kissing Quick. Still a little forced considering we haven't really seen how the reluctant date went, but fuck it. Still dazed about that kiss, Quick comes home and bumps into Chrissy. Literally. They quickly apologize to each other and Quick's about to confess his feelings to Chrissy when Sky pops out in handcuffs. And I know comedy and humor is subjective, but the strip then ends with the punchline being a super unfunny exclamation from Quick, despite he should be used to this by now. Like, the joke here is that Quick is making a funny sounding exclamation that is not your typical, "Oh god damn it." I mean, the joke is basically this. Oh my goddamn shit fuck bitch tits, Kama Sutra, Nord Noises, Luftballon, Titty Twister, Tuesday, Campfire, ugh! I am the one, the way your son, don't need a gun to get respect up on the street. Also, really? Dude, you can break cuffs like that with a goddamn shoe. And why would Quick know where the key is for them?
Guess that explains what Reiko meant when she said the relationship was open.
Now, just as we've all happily forgotten that the whole ninja thing is a thing, they are introducing it again with this chick here arriving seemingly with the goal of defeating Reiko. As they leave the airport, the ninja Jasmine and whatever the shit this thing Jabby is, talk about Reiko and how they're here to check up on her for the matriarch as they seemingly haven't seen her since she left with Sky. What's that, ninja? Guys? Guys, what are you doing? Is this for real? Is this a joke or... Cause you're really not done anything to build this up. Anyway, Jasmine sends Jeffy or whatever the fuck out to find and get Reiko so he can bring her to Jasmine, who in turn will be outbreaking in her new credit card. When Reiko finds Jasmine, it seems like, and I'm not making this up, that Jasmine is able to completely halt Reiko's movements with ninja magic due to a card. But Reiko is able to freeze all of Jasmine's movements in turn by poking her butt. Okay, so... There's magic now. The hell happened? You can't just spend the start of the comic showing real-life things in a real-life world and then out of left field introduce paranormal elements like they've always been there. Ease us into it.
To put it into catbox terms, introducing a paranormal element is like sex. You can't just jam it in there. You first gotta warm us up to it. Buy us flour first. Massage our feet. Tell us we're pretty.
Even Sky seems to be used to this as Reiko and Jasmine and even seems to know how to get someone out of the whole body lock technique. Meanwhile, some girl is talking about how she is scored and wants to know all the nitty-gritty details about Quick's date right in front of Chrissy, which of course makes her run away and cry. We then move back again to Reiko and Jasmine, and it's revealed that these two are sisters. Why is one of them having a Japanese name and the other hasn't? Why are they both in ninja costumes? I can see Jasmine cause she's fresh off the plane, but why is Reiko constantly walking around in this outfit? She isn't even at work, nor was she prior to getting there. Anyway, they fight and... What the hell is happening to your body here, lady? Look at it! Her hip is all the way out here, there's no real indication of her waist, where the hell is her spine? How's her body twisted exactly? Anyway, they fight, and I swear I've seen this exact same shot before, but I don't know where, and instead of breaking them up, Sky decides to take bets on who will win. Once again, turning this drama into just more stuff, where a girl can be hard for the spectators. Reiko finishes the fight with an Insuna drop into some water. A fountain, or... Anyway, after the fight, Reiko says, "Now that was a nice workout, Not better than getting shagged, but still fun.
If this chick had any less of a personality than simply being a thing for you to come inside, she'd be a goddamn fleshlight with bunny ears.
Jasmine admits her defeat to Reiko and then falls over due to being dizzy from being Izuna dropped into a fountain that you cannot convince me had more than a foot and a half worth of water to cushion the fall. She falls over, but luckily the super amazing handsome guy with long bushy hair is there to grab her, even though he was nowhere near earlier. She's even blushing, for God's sake. Anyway, Crick quickly discards Jasmine into a bush and tries to explain to Chrissy that he did indeed not have sex with anyone. They are however interrupted when a customer asks for some pie. Why would an old lady like this go to what is basically a fetishist cosplay video game restaurant? When Chrissy returns, Quick has forgotten that he was trying to explain himself, however, and instead asks Chrissy out in the most whipped way possible. Reiko decides to step in and tells Chrissy they're going to the beach, and Quick will be buying everyone all the ice cream they can eat, to which both Chrissy and Jasmine agree to go along. Meanwhile, in the shadows, in the background, are two other female ninjas keeping a watchful eye on the gang.
How about that? A group just got together and now an ominous figure in the shadows is watching them and scheming something. This is turning into a more juvenile version than Les Lindis, but with better anatomy.
Better! To the beach we go, but not until Raven asks Quick over for a really not that subtle quickie, but Quick declines, not realizing what she's offering, only to then berate himself about needing to get a clue sometimes, indirectly telling us that if he had caught onto what Raven was offering, he'd be over there screwing her brains out, even though he's gunning for Chrissy. I've seen soggy noodles with more of a backbone than this guy. Anyway, it's obviously time for the obligatory beach scene, and besides showcasing everyone in a bikini, all seemingly having the same bust size, the next few pages are spent on Quick and Chrissy being questioned about where they stand in their relationship, despite only Quick has really shown any signs of wishing to be in a relationship. But even so, Chrissy is just coming out and saying she wouldn't mind fucking Quick, but she can't cause he has Raven. I think I'd have to make an active effort to find a more forced growth of interest in a character. Holy shit. Like, where the shit does this come from? It turns out the teacher, Trevor, is here and... Say, I know this isn't just Godai's style that has a fault here, but... What's the deal with anthro characters and having fur some places and some places they don't? Like... Does the fur stop at the chest to show defined pecs? What about the girl's breasts? Are they hairy? How can fur be glossy like wet skin? What about the hair? Why is that a different color than the fur? Shouldn't it technically be the same color or at least close?
It's been... How many years? And I'm still finding new ways to confuse myself about furries.
So while Quick is sulking over Trevor mixed up, Muffin gunning for Chrissy, these two strangers, Janice and Flux, decides to walk up to Quick and give him some tips.
A bit of advice, man. Don't let pretty boy Green over there steal your thunder. Be assertive. Women love that stuff, right, Janice?
And Janice replies,
Yes, it took Flux 3 minutes and BAM! We were hiding Christmas presents, if you know what I mean.
Welcome to my personal space. How the fuck can I help you?
Seriously, what kind of couple just walks up to a stranger, give dating tips, and then very graphically tells how they had sex? Anyway, Trevor invites them to his beach house, which he just so happens to have. How much money does the people in this universe have anyway? And here, in front of everyone else, Trevor finds it a great time to ask Chrissy to spend the night with him, which riles Quick up, making him step in. But hey, actual drama we might be interested in seeing will have to wait. And I say wait, but in fact it just gets dropped on the floor, cause now it's time for Reiko and Jasmine to get attacked by ninjas who've been sent to track them down. One of the ninjas, however, manages to jump down and faceplant from a tree, possibly killing herself. The other, however, manages to dig out a katana from her cleavage.
What? What? I don't mind that. It makes fun of how stacked she is and it's not taking itself too seriously. It's funny.
It does, however, make me question that if your job was to track down the two girls, why are you even bothering attacking them? Let alone with a sharp weapon.
just call up your client and tell him, yo, Dad, this beach, they're wearing swimwear, and one of them has apparently broken a fucking elbow! Anyway, they fight, or rather, there's hardly even a fight, because Jasmine just throws one of her
ninja info cards
on her forehead, and she's unable to move. It turns out that the client in question is in possession of a very compromising picture of Reiko and Jasmine. As a result of this, Jasmine and Reiko try to flee along with their friends, but that's until he shows up. Reginald Graves. Okay, I swear I gotta be the only asshole in the world who's having an issue with this, but what the fuck is a human now doing in this world? I could kinda get behind if everyone were anthros, cause hey, that's just how Godai chose to present his characters. They could be stick figures and it wouldn't really matter. But now you got humans and anthros in the same universe? Okay, so is there a different race? Why haven't we seen one until now? Is Reginald special? If not, are the anthros we've seen thus far special? Do they just coexist? Can they have children? Are there crossbreeds? What would a crossbreed between a human and a furry even look like?
People who ask questions are not the intended readers for these kinds of comics.
Anyway, Reginald is here and he doesn't really do anything. Like, his entire thing is that he has a contract for Jasmine and Reiko so he can, I think, release pictures of those two having incestuous sex or some shit. Really? You spent money on trained ninjas to track down two girls just so you could get them to sign a contract that quite clearly is never gonna get signed? Shouldn't you instead use that money on a super good lawyer? Couldn't you just have found them in a goddamn phone book? Googled their names? But that is when Quick has the genius idea of ripping up Reginald's contract. Ah, yes. The contracts that are still, to this very day, all written with pen and parchment, of which there is only but a single one in existence. He can just fucking print out another one! You destroying the paper won't fucking do anything! He probably has the Word file open on his laptop right fucking now! And then, not making this up, Quick for some reason first acts like Reiko is his fiancé, and then without anyone prompting him to, on the next page, he pretends to be the pimp of both Reiko and Jasmine to try and fool Reginald. Obviously, he's not buying it, but even then, what the hell would it accomplish to pretend to be a pimp? If anything, shouldn't they be the type of girls who'd want to get publicity if they were indeed hookers? You are their pimp. You earn money from them hookering themselves out. What the heck is going on? And then, I swear to God that this is true. Quick slaps Jasmine's ass as part of this whole pimp act and is sent to the hospital, and that is the end of this confrontation.
I have never, in all my years of doing this show, covering the worst of the worst of webcomics, everything from Traced comics to Sonnet 2, seen a confrontation handled this poorly.
Nothing was done. Nothing was accomplished. Nothing fucking happened. A dude with no context to anything or anyone appears out of nowhere with a contract to make a deal with Reiko and Jasmine based on them getting drunk and having incestuous sex. One guy rips up the contract, pretends to be Reiko's fiance, and then pretends to be her pimp, comes in, gets punched, and is sent to the hospital. And he wasn't even punched by the antagonist, but by one of the ladies as a comedic punchline to an unfunny joke. There's no conclusion. Heck, there wasn't even any build-up. Who the fuck is this dude, and who were the ninjas? What was their goal, their motivation? How does Reiko and Jasmine know them? Are they from the kingdom where Reiko and Jasmine are from? This scene makes the scene in Cloud Scratcher where they just walk away from the antagonist look like a real goddamn hostage situation in comparison, for fuck's sake.
Okay, Godai, look here.
So this is how you write a confrontation. You introduce the conflict, then you introduce the agency of the conflict. What does the different parties stand to gain or lose upon winning or losing this confrontation?
You have a climax happen, something that determines who wins or loses the confrontation, and then you conclude the conflict with the sentence, and because of that. What we saw here seemed less like a conclusion to a confrontation, but rather a commercial break for a goddamn TV show, and then when we get back, it's just done. It's like this.
You scared, motherfucker? Well, you should be, because this Green Beret's gonna kick your big ass.
I eat Green Berets for breakfast.
Who's that Pokemon?
It's Pikachu!
It's Clefairy!
Fuck!
No chance.
Moving on, I guess. Quick is back home from the hospital, and he's being treated kind of like a hero, despite not really doing anything. Chrissy has even cut her hair. If anything, they should be thanking Reiko. I mean, she got the last laugh by sending Reginald to the Blue Oyster, and if you don't understand what this means, you got some classic movies to look up on, my friend. In fact, major kudos to Godai for that reference. Anyway, time to ride Quick's dick a little more, as now it's Chrissy's turn to thank Quick for helping her, and again, he didn't really do anything. Is that in between Chrissy and Trevor? Sure, but Chrissy could just say, no, I don't want to sleep with you, and that would have been it. I mean, was Trevor gonna force himself on Chrissy in front of several students? Anyway, Chrissy reveals that she actually heard Quick say he wished to joyride her Swiss Alps. No, really. They are reusing that term, and this sets the stage for Quick to then kiss Chrissy.
What a mood setter, right? Like, nothing gets you weak in the knees like I wanna joyride your Swiss Alps. It's like, sploosh!
Alright, you fucking slag, you wanna come back to me mom's ass and I'll have a go at smashing your fanny? I'm gonna use your ass for the old slap and tickle while me mom makes me some fucking cheese toasties.
Anyway, even Chrissy thinks this is a little too much and stops the kiss despite seeming to be very into it earlier. She tells Quick that she don't want to do anything because she doesn't want to hurt anyone and wants to make sure that Raven just sees Quick as a friend and nothing more, which is surprisingly well-mannered and good thinking for this comic. You know, the comic called Rascals. Anyway, this page ends with a clear sign of just how forced this whole sex thing is, cause Quick is writing it all to this one dude online, and even though that could just be it, the strip has to end with this super nobody being asked to come to bed by a super stacked girl in just her underwear. Why does this have to end with sex? Like, I'm not minding that sex is in there, but it's freaking crammed down my throat at this point. So, Quick has to choose between either Chrissy, who he has time and time again showed his admiration for, or Raven, who... I gotta be honest, I kinda forgot she was even a thing, cause the comic hasn't really bothered showing us her that much. Quick thinks to himself, choose, huh? Easier said than done. Okay, no, fuck you. First of all, it's Dan, with an A. And second of all, no! It's not hard! Just fucking go see Raven and tell her, hi, mouse chick that has shown no interest in me other than for sexual purposes. Remember the girl I initially wanted to give those tickets to? Well, we are kind of becoming a thing now, and I just want to make sure you're cool with it. But nope, Quick shows up at Raven's door, and she answers the door in a freaking hot pants and a loose sports bra. But hey, that's so Raven.
Thank you. You're looking great. Thank you. You're still great. Don't forget to tip your waitress. I'll be here all week, ladies and gentlemen.
Raven asks Quick to stay because she needs his help with something. In the meantime, we cut back to Reiko and Chrissy, and oh my god, does this comic have ADHD or something? It jumps and bounces around everywhere. There's too much going on without anything happening. Even when there's something serious going on, it just skips it. Be that as it may, this super giant stacked chick walks in and hugs Chrissy. It turns out her name is Jolty. Again, is that a name? And then, you guessed it, we move back to Quick and Raven, who are playing World of Warcraft. Quick, having the approximate determination and spine worth of jellyfish, hasn't told Raven off yet, and is instead helping her play as well as admiring her curves, especially when Raven breaks into a victory booty dance. I like to say that that's forced, but everyone who's seen some of the more popular Twitch girl streamers know that this is a very real and very sad thing. Back at the dorm, nothing is really happening other than Jolty claiming her tits are in dire need of some rubbing for whatever reason. While explaining why she is here, both Sky and Chrissy admires her curves. Jolty explains that the reason she is here is because she wants Reiko to try her curry, because Reiko apparently has an iron stomach. And back to Quick and Raven. After trying several times but breaking down, Quick finally ends up talking to Raven about Chrissy. Raven's only question is whether or not they fucked, and when saying no, she's very quick to try and get with Quick. He tries to stop her, but to no avail, as she more or less tackles Quick. They are however stopped when a random dude comes in to show Raven some wrestling.
And that's it for this time. I want you guys to try and guess just how many pages we covered in this one episode. 100. I do not think I can possibly come up with one comic where so much stuff was going on, yet so little stuff actually happened. So join me next time as we dive even further into the comic of Rascals, for better or for worse. I see you guys at the next webcomic belief. Take care till next time. Thank you for watching this episode of the Webcomic Relief. I kind of think like if I ever have any announcements, I will put them here, so you have even more incentives to stay after the credits. And for now, well, you probably already saw it in the credits, but we now have a Discord chat. There will be a link in the description. Please do come and join. It is for people who, you know, just want to talk with other people who are still, you know, interested in the same medium. You can talk about art, writing, share thoughts, push your streams. If anyone has any kind of commission thing they want to, you know, boost, you can do that there as well. And you get to shoot the shit with me and a bunch of other people. For example, all the people from the Jello Cartello. And you also get to, you know, be there when the Jello Cartello is going live and share your work there. Like, it's just, you know, like a small little group where the Webcomic Belief community can stay and talk among ourselves. So please do go and check it out and be sure to read the rules so everyone can get along. This episode has been sponsored by a bunch of amazing people, so you know the drill. Let's get started.
CloudyDaze. CloudyDaze wants me to push a Kickstarter for a book known as The Sanity Circus. The Sanity Circus seems to be a story about a girl on the run who joins up with a bunch of different people who all have their own little quirks and abilities and stuff like that. It looks really interesting, so by all means, if you got the money or the time, go check it out.
Amocin. Amocin is working on a comic called Druids, which is a mature-themed fantasy comic in the world of Warcraft. If you're interested in a more mature story from that world, check it out. Aiden Baumann. Aiden wants me to push a comic called Flowerpot, which is a comic about an outbreak of a sickness called Fleurine that causes flowers to grow in your body. You like The Last of Us? Then check this one out. Jordan Burke. Jordan wants me to push the fanfic called The Adventure Auditions. It is the first of a possible series in which Ed, Ed, and Eddie decide to write an adventure novel. But their quest for material turns into a journey where they learn who they truly are and what they are capable of. Nana Newcomb. Nana wants me to push the webcomic called Blackbird, which is a very mature and very fresh blow of air in the whole superhero scene done by an incredibly passionate fan of the superhero comic medium. If you want to see a passion project about superheroes, go check out Blackbird. Nicholas Knudsen. Nicholas doesn't want me to push anything, so for now just know that he is the realest OG, just like as he was last time. Hitori the Artist. Hitori is working on a new fantasy comic. It's a comic about furries, magic, steampunk, and a multiverse. Get ready, because this is probably going to be amazing. Alex J. Alex J is working on Death's My Bitch. Teddy finds himself in an awkward position when he accidentally kills the Grim Reaper and has to take up the office of Death. Now the new Death, he finds out that the Grim Reavers are more human than he thought. Megan Smith. Megan is working on a webcomic called 8 World, which takes a completely different spin on the whole destined lovers trope. Trust me, you've never seen a romance quite like this. Lariokun. Lariokun, my good friend, is working on the adult webcomic called Yav, which is taking a different spin on romance and other very mature themes. It's a furry comic made by a master in the craft. Go check it out. Kathy Catlin. Kathy is working on Alien Shores, which is a webcomic about a young man facing indecisions about his future, the friends he makes, and the trials life throws at them as they try to become successful rock musicians, from parental disapproval to attempted murder. Shane Asher. Shane is working on the webcomic called Strays of Saravia. This comic tickles a personal fancy of mine, which is a superhero comic with anthropomorphic characters. It's a comic with a lot of charm, so check it out. Samantha Shakespeare. Samantha Shakespeare wants me to push one of their friends who is now doing commissions. You can see all the amazing work you can get done here on screen as well as the prices. You can go to the link in the description and find out more, but you can also contact them on both Twitter and Tumblr. So go check it out. Danny Richard. Danny Richard wants me to push the comic known as Saturday Night Seance. When he moved his young family to the leafy suburbs of Crossroads Point, the last thing that David Hope expected to encounter was the supernatural. But that's just what he got. And with black magic, beer, and a love triangle, what could possibly go wrong? Get ready for one hell of a night in Saturday Night Seance. Go check it out. Lutzo Valazzo. I'm sorry if I butchered that name. Hasn't gotten back to me about what they wanted me to push, so if anything comes up, by all means, go check out the description and make sure to check out whatever it is that they want me to push. And let's not forget, Sebastian Vanborg, V-Man, Lexia Velez, Thomas Nostar, Shiv, Scott Fraser, Joe Barber, and Drika of Adrian. And also, a huge kudos to all the people you see here. And once more, I'd like to say that Patreon is kind of fucking up right now. So if your name isn't here or you are not getting the rewards that you want, by all means, let me know and I'll refund all the money that has been withdrawn. You don't deserve to just have your money taken when, you know, I'm not delivering on it. So if anything is wrong, by all means, let me know. If you want to support the show, change my life, and make it so I can live off of YouTube and entertain people, please go to my Patreon. Here you can donate anything you want every month and you will get a ton of awesome rewards for it. Just go to www.patreon.com/Riiser with two eyes. You can also go to TeePublic and get your hands on some of the new webcomic relief merch. The link is in the description. If you don't want to support the show financially, at least think about liking the video, subscribing to the channel, or sharing your favorite webcomic relief episode with your friends. I'll see you guys in the next webcomic relief. Take care.